Morning, everybody. Welcome to IPMG's Professional Development Workshop today, and we are very excited to have with us Julie Reynolds, who is our Deputy of Strategic Initiatives with the Division of Disability and Rehab Services, and Kim Opsahl, who is a consultant with the Division of Disability and Rehab Services. And we're very grateful that they've come to share with us today. I just wanted to review really quickly with you all that the training has been approved for 1 hour of external training with Advocare. In order to get the certificate of attendance for case managers specifically, you do need to be logged on for the entire duration of the training, except for the Q&A portion. You will be able to submit your confirmation straight into Advocare like we normally do. You'll be getting that confirmation from the email you see on your screen. It will take up to 2 days, so don't expect it today, but within a couple of days you will get that. If you have any problems after a couple of days, you're welcome to reach out to us and we will help you with that. Along with that, within a couple of days of the training, you will get a link to the recording from today, any associated materials, and the QA. So all of that will be sent directly to you if you've registered. And we always appreciate and welcome feedback. So a survey regarding this particular workshop will launch immediately after the PDW has ended. And then a quick promo for in August, we will have Heather Sorrells and Carol Underwood, which are IPMG's assistant directors, and they are going to talk about supporting individuals in the family home. This is a presentation they did for a conference, and so we wanted to bring that to you. So, without further delay, I am going to change this over to our presenters, and they will be with you in just a moment.
Wonderful. Thanks so much, Jennifer.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. This is Julie Reynolds. So for about the past year, Kim and I have been working on supporting families through the LifeCourse Framework, our community of practice that Indiana has become a member of. It's probably almost a year, we're reaching our anniversary. So we're very excited today to really go through what the LifeCourse is, what we mean by supporting families, what are some of the ways we are hoping to really have some transformative change in our systems of supports to individuals in Indiana. So this is a long-term initiative for DDRS that Kylie and everyone, and Kathy and everyone in the division is very, very excited about. So for the most part of the presentation, because we do it together on a webinar, we just look silly. So,
great. Thanks, Julie, and thanks everyone for joining us this morning. As Julie said, we really appreciate the opportunity to talk with all of you about the LifeCourse Framework and Indiana's participation in the National Community of Practice for Supporting Families. So as we get started, we always like to start here with why are we even here and having these conversations, and why is the division looking at moving in this direction? And for us, really, it comes down to this mission statement. And this really comes from the community of practice, but the division is pretty wholeheartedly adopted it. And I'm sure it's pretty consistent with the mission and vision that most of you bring to the table. But what we're really looking at is that through this work, they'll have the right to live, love, work, learn, participate, play, and pursue their dreams in their community. It's a pretty big statement, but really at the end of the day, I think when we reflect on the work that we do in support of folks with disabilities here in Indiana, it really is what we're hoping to achieve through the support that we provide. The one thing that I will make note of is when the community practice first started, this statement actually said all people with disabilities, and they very quickly removed that because what they really learned, and hopefully what you'll really see through some of the principles and the tools of the LifeCourse, is that this is really about all people, and that this is a way of thinking and a way of supporting folks that kind of transcends disability and should be something that we're thinking about across the board for folks. So the other piece of that statement you'll notice starts with the word all. So one of the concepts of the LifeCourse Framework is really looking at all folks with disabilities, not just those that are known to us. So what does that mean here in Indiana? So when we look at kind of prevalence data about the prevalence of disability, and we look at our census data from 2015, what that suggests is that there's upwards of 104,000 Hoosiers who have a developmental disability. When we look at that compared to the folks that we know who are receiving BDDS-funded services, what that tells us is that about almost 74% of the estimated Hoosiers with developmental disabilities are not known to the BEADS service system. About 1.5% of those folks are currently on the wait list, and about 25% are actually in paid services. So a couple things with this particular kind of set of data is, one, Indiana is really consistent with the national trends in this area, where we see nationally on average we have about 25% of folks that are known to the service delivery system and about 75% who are out and kind of receiving, you know, kind of creating natural supports for themselves and living pretty independently in the community. Now, when we look at this data, you know, the first, Julie, when we do this presentation, Julie will often say, you know, at first she kind of started to hyperventilate looking at this data, thinking that we were going to have to figure out a way to create a service delivery system that brought in that 75% that aren't known to the system. And really, Kylie, as well as I think looking at the principles of the life course, what we do is say that's not really what this slide is about. What this slide is about is saying, you know, we've got folks in that 74% who are probably doing really well. And as a system, we probably have a lot to learn from them about how they have built a system of supports around themselves or around their family that really work for them. And what can we learn from that? There are certainly folks in that 74% who could probably really benefit from the paid service delivery system. So another aspect is, how do we make sure folks understand those pathways and that we're then using resources across the all so that we can create that opportunity for access for folks across the board. So that really kind of brings us to, you know, why the LifeCourse framework? Why is the division looking at this particular approach and kind of what's happening? So I think we all are aware we're in an environment where there are a lot of broad policy changes happening that have a direct impact on the services that folks receive here in Indiana. And right now, you know, we've got issues around the Workforce Investment and Opportunity Act and some changes that those are making and the impact those have on employment for folks. We have the home and community-based settings rule from the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare and Medicaid Services that are really dictating kind of the direction that home and community-based services should be moving. What are the characteristics that make a setting or make a service home and community-based? So we've certainly all heard a lot about that has been popular, kind of percolating since 2014, and the division has a current transition plan in place, how they're going to start moving in that direction. Planning. So one of the things CMS published, the Senate published a rule around person-centered planning, really encouraging states to move more appreciably in that direction. In a lot of ways, Indiana is pretty aligned with CMS's direction, but we know we've got some opportunity to improve our practice in that area. And then certainly we've got pressures related to kind of resource limitations, both in terms of people in our workforce and having enough staff, frankly, at all levels to help provide the level of support that folks need, and then the funding to back that up. And right now we have all of those pressures kind of pushing in on the person within the context of their family and kind of that paid service delivery system. At the same time, We know that folks are asking something more of the service delivery system itself. So we know that folks are really interested in having more opportunity for choice, more opportunity for community-based options, and more opportunity just in general to be an integral part of their community and how the service delivery system can support them in that aspiration. So when we look at our current service delivery system, I think this is a really great kind of graphic image that helps, I think, identify where we are today as well as where the division is hoping to move in the future. So we start at the far end of that, and everyone, ourselves, the folks that we support, everyone starts as a person within the context of their family, within the context of their greater community. When we look at traditionally the way that we've approached services and supports then for folks with disabilities is that we've really wrapped this, the paid service system around the person. And unfortunately, while it certainly was never the intent, I think in practice what we see happen oftentimes is the services wind up getting wrapped maybe a little too tightly, and that they become more of a barrier to the person kind of living within the context of their family and their community. And so what we're hoping to achieve as we move down the path of the life course and some of the shifts, cultural shifts that happen with that, is that we wind up in that far graphic where we're looking at taking supports, integrated supports, and kind of, for lack of better terminology, sprinkling them in the places where they're going to be most effective for folks. That we start looking at services and supports with that understanding that the person really does exist within their family and their community, and how do we use supports in a way that maintains whatever good is happening in that, and then helps facilitate opportunities where maybe folks are feeling like they need a bit more assistance or support. So in a lot of ways, I think, we were recently at a national conference of the states who are participating in the community of practice. And the University of Missouri at Kansas City is really the lead kind of organization on this. They developed a lot of the life course framework and the principles and values around it, so really are the gurus, if you will, in this arena. But in talking about this particular slide, Shelley Reynolds, who is the lead at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, said, you know, what this for her really represents is, one, this is very consistent with the direction that the home and community-based settings rule is pushing states to move in. But more importantly, like, this is really captures why many of us who are professionals in the field are in the field, that we really all aspire to figuring out how do we use services and supports in a way that really helps a person stay within their family, stay within the community, and really enhance their life versus creating barriers for that, additional barriers for that individual. So I think the division is really clear that this isn't going to be, you know, this is a real shift in thinking at all levels within the system, including within the state systems that support services. And so we're really at a point where we need transformational change to really move forward. And so that really means, you know, a couple things. That, you know, up till now, in the past few years, we've done a lot of things because we've always done them that way, or we've nibbled around the edges and making maybe more some transitional change to maybe resolve a particular challenge in the system, but not really stepping back and looking at how could we change the total approach. And like I said, I think at this point, where things seem to be headed is through the life course, that this is maybe really an opportunity for some transformational change in the system. And so what that really means is that using some of these tools and these principles, that we can work together to develop a shared vision for the future, that we work together to invest in cultural change, that we make sure that folks with disabilities and their families are informed, that they're able to make informed decision-making at all levels of this change, so that it's not change about them, but it's change with them. That we find ways to remove obstacles to ensure everyone can live and work to their greatest potential, and that we're developing a solid foundation and thinking beyond the norm. So is a lot in those statements and a lot of, certainly aspirations, but I think the division is really invested in seeing how we can start all together moving in these directions. So in thinking about this transformational change, certainly what we're looking at is using the supporting families community practice as a way to create a framework for that discussion. So let's start a little bit about what is this national community practice and the life course framework. So up on the screen now, you're going to see some, kind of some basics about the project and the goals. So this really started as a project that was funded by the Administration for Community Living at the federal level. And it involved five states in its initial first 3 years of existence. And these states came together with this goal in mind. How do we share community, how do we share practices and information across states so that we can better assist supporting families moving forward? You know, historically, prior to this point in time, I think systems had often talked about family support. But one of the challenges in framing it as family support is oftentimes that got boiled down to a program. And so we didn't think about how you support families, rather we thought about a program that we could put in place that might help some families. And so part of this is really shifting that thinking to really you know, we oftentimes are talking here from a division perspective of how are we integrating life course thinking and thinking about how to support families and all of the things that the division is doing, so that that's always kind of a first consideration as we're moving forward. So what that means, you know, earlier we saw the slide. I apologize, I'm ahead of myself. So let's talk about what the life course is in a nutshell. So, you know, as we've talked about already, we start with the person. They are at the center of all of this. But then we think about, you know, none of us think of ourselves in a vacuum, right? We all think of ourselves in the context of our family. So when we're looking at supporting folks with disabilities, we need to do the same thing. So thinking about what that means. And I do want to take a quick moment to say family can mean a lot of things. Family is really based on what the person defines as family. So it could be mom and dad, siblings, that sort of thing. But it also could be maybe good friends and neighbors that the person has that they really consider and rely on, as we might with more traditional families. So we really do look to the person, and it's not intended to be a limiting term, but rather to say that person doesn't live in a vacuum by themselves. There's a core community or family around them that we really need to take into consideration when we're thinking about effective services and supports. So then around that, then we're looking at the person's life through the lens of, in life course terminology, life domains. But we all have areas of our life that we are planning around and supporting ourselves in. And again, we're going to do that same thing with the folks that we support. So up here on the screen, you'll see where I'm going to start here at the top. We have daily life and employment, social and spirituality, safety and security, community living, healthy living, and citizenship and advocacy. And in a lot of ways, you know, sometimes I think we do touch on these, but I think as a service delivery system, oftentimes we are spending a lot of time maybe in a couple of these areas. Safety and security and healthy living certainly come to mind. And what I think is the important lesson in the life domains is really helping all of us to remember we really need to be thinking about and planning in each of these areas. And that regardless of where I am in my life course, all of these areas are relevant. So, you know, for instance, when we're talking about daily life and employment, that is a conversation we should be having with folks regardless of what age they are. Now, the conversation will be different depending on your age, but even when, you know, when you're three, we need to be starting to have some conversations about, you know, it's not going to be, you know, what job does Kim want at the age of three, but we're going to talk about what are some reasonable expectations or expectations that we should be setting for folks so that we're setting high expectations at the outside. You know, just like any kiddo who's three, we're talking about things like, what do you want to be when you grow up? We're practicing different occupations. You know, when you think about kiddos who are in that 5 or 6 age range, they're starting to, you know, play teacher or play waitress, and that we're encouraging that's kind of the typical kind of behavior that we also want to see for folks with disabilities, and that we encourage families to expect that and encourage that so that we start setting folks on a trajectory for their life that is based on high expectation. Wrapped around those life domains, then we think about supports. Now, I always joke with folks, so in life course terminology, they refer to these as the three buckets, but they're not the three buckets that we've all come to love through the waiver program, but rather these are three buckets of support that all families need and benefit from. So again, I think this is an area where I think for the service delivery system, for us to really look at how are we effectively talking about all of these types of supports with the folks that we support and their families. We spend a lot of time in the bottom bucket, which is that orange bucket that says goods and services. You know, we spend a lot of time talking about the waiver in particular and how that's going to support a person. We might spend time talking about VR, or if the person is residing in a group home setting, perhaps group home, but kind of those paid goods and services. But and those are important. But in addition to those, folks also need access to supports that help them discover and navigate. So help them to think about things that they might have an interest in, or more fully explore things that are of interest to them. Learn about a variety of things that may have impact on their life, and then connecting and networking. So how do we help folks to connect with others who have a shared experience, whether that's a shared experience around disability or maybe a shared experience in relation to a hobby or other interest. But all of those supports are really important and really help us build a full level of support around an individual. And then the final kind of piece of the LifeCourse framework, and this is probably one of my favorite parts, particularly kind of in this context looking at it all together, is this outer ring. And the reason why I like this outer ring is that I think as a system for many years we have talked about the importance and the need for natural supports in a person's life. But unfortunately, I think that conversation, that's kind of where that conversation sometimes often ends, because as a system, I don't know that we've always done a good job of really then articulating, well, what do we mean by natural support and what does that look like in a person's life? And so the reason I like this kind of outer circle is because I think it starts to articulate what natural support might look like and how that looks in the context of paid support. So at the top of this outer ring, we start with the person and their family, and what are their strengths and assets? What do they bring to the table? And how do we think about building on those strengths and assets when we're looking at providing support to that person? So, you know, real quick example of this that may help in terms of context of how we might think about this a little bit differently is a colleague shared a story that, you know, this colleague who works with school-aged folks and said, you know, we work really hard at helping folks develop skills with public transportation. But what we see oftentimes is when we put waiver services in place, one of the first things we might do is actually put the person in a car with a direct support professional. And not think about how do we continue to maintain and build the skills that we've developed using public transportation. So that's something, you know, I know we do this to a certain degree with some of our person-centered planning, but really exploring that and making sure that that's kind of the base that we start from. And then looking at relationship-based support. So who is involved in that person's life? Who do they rely on and consider to be family, friend, or otherwise? And then we include eligibility-specific supports because we're really looking at this within the context of all supports. So that could be waiver, that could be VR, but it could be other things. It could be public housing, could be food stamps, could be other things that maybe the person is eligible for because they work for a particular employer, those sorts of things. Community-based supports are those broader supports that are available to anyone in the community. So that could be church, it could be the Y, could be the library or classes that are held through the library. And then finally, technology, which I think represents for Indiana as a system probably the biggest opportunity to explore. But how do we use technology at all levels to support folks? And that could be very low-tech technology, meaning I use an alarm clock to get up in the morning, or it could be higher touch, higher tech, that maybe I'm using FaceTime to engage with my employment consultant to help me make sure I'm on task with work, or maybe I'm using my phone to navigate public transportation, that it's providing me some level of support there. So that's kind of, in a nutshell, how all of these pieces and parts come together to form the LifeCourse framework itself. So when we go back to this slide here, and in terms of folks kind of where we stand today as a service delivery system, where we have the person within the context of their family wrapped, around with the service delivery system, trying to kind of work at how do we get to more choice, community options, integration, that we're now using that LifeCourse lens that continues to build on that, but add some new elements that we can use in helping move us towards greater opportunity in those areas. So I've mentioned through talking through the LifeCourse, mentioned a couple key terms, but I want to touch on a few that are really central to the LifeCourse framework. First are trajectories. So this really starts to get us in some of the basic planning tools that are part of the LifeCourse framework. And what I'm going to say is a couple things as we get started on this. I think it's really important to keep in mind that the LifeCourse framework itself and the tools that we're going to go over were developed by families for families. So I think the brilliance in that is what I hope you'll see as we walk through them is they're pretty straightforward and they're very intuitive. I have found them very easy to use and really natural to use. And I think the best impact of that is that they are tools that families and self-advocates can use without the assistance or support of a professional. So they're tools that they can really use and then bring to their case manager, bring to their school or to their IDT and say, I've really been thinking about where I want to head in life and here's some information and I need your help in these areas. So let's start with the trajectory tool. So the trajectory tool really just helps us start to set up some basics about the person and the types, kind of where they're wanting to head in life. We start there at the upper right, and we're talking in that, we're really talking about what is a good life for that person. What does that look like? Who does it include? What's happening? And what would a good life look like for them? In the bottom right, then, we're talking about what is it what I don't want to have happen in my life? That can be just as important as what I do want to have happen, so that we've got real awareness of what we want to avoid and where we want, where we aspire to be. And then the trajectory really just helps us start to plot out what can I do that moves me closer to the good life vision that I have for myself, and what are the things that maybe are moving me in the direction that I want to avoid. So many of you may be familiar with this. This was actually the tool that we used as we went around, as Kylie went around with the Arc of Indiana last fall to do some fall forums. It was a tool that we used in talking with families and self-advocates about where they wanted to see the system move. And so here's an example of kind of what that looked like. So we asked folks kind of what was their vision for a good life for Hoosiers with disabilities, the things we wanted to avoid. And then we talked about what the system was currently doing that either moved us towards that vision or was moving us away from the vision. And then a really important part of that conversation was what more could we do that would move us even closer to that vision. So I think it's a good, also this is a good example to show that this tool is really flexible in terms of it can be used at an individual level and it can be used at a systems level. And then another nice feature of it is that you can add a few enhancements that help you get at maybe some specific areas. So I'm going to show you, this is Ben. So Ben is Jane St. John's son. So Jane is a part of the University of Missouri at Kansas City team. And her son Ben has a disability and lives with Jane and her husband. And has a pretty full life. So this is Ben's life trajectory. And so you see, this is, it takes a step, a little step further than the one that we just showed you, in that it kind of places Ben on the trajectory. So you see him there in the middle at that time at his current age of 25. And so the team worked with Ben and with his family to say, okay, what is that vision for a good life at this point in time? What are the things we want to avoid? So you see Ben's really into wrestling and tattoos and volunteering at the fire station. So you see in sports, they were clear about the things that they wanted to avoid or didn't want to see happen in Ben's life. And then they talked about what were Ben's prior life experiences and plotted those, not just kind of a list of what had he done, but really plotted them in terms of saying, well, was that a past life experience that pushed us towards the vision of a good life, or was it pulling us away? And then the team used it to talk about what more could we be doing to support Ben in moving towards that vision of a good life, and what were the things that maybe moving forward we wanted to work on because they were really moving us in a direction we didn't want to head. One of the other ways that the trajectory concept is used is in this area of anticipatory guidance. So anticipatory guidance is a common terminology used particularly in pediatric care, but it's really about helping families to anticipate what is going to be happening with their child and from a developmental perspective and those sorts of things. And so we apply it here to say, you know, as families are thinking about, you know, supporting their child in particular when they're under 18 towards moving towards a good life, you know, really helping the family to think about what does a good life look like in 5 years, in 10 years for my son or daughter, but also to think about what are the things then based on that long-term vision, what are some of the things we should be working on today that have a likelihood of putting us on that trajectory towards that good life that we've articulated. So, you know, that's really where we start drawing in some of these concepts of life course to say, well, what are other kids at age 14 doing? And how can we use our services and supports to really help that young person to participate just like their peers in those activities so that we're not creating a parallel life for them, but we're really helping them to engage in the same kind of life as their peers are engaging in. It's also about, you know, learning important skills. So we talked about work, for instance. You know, if I'm 7 or 8 years old, one of the important things that mom and dad are probably going to start doing is having me do chores to earn money so that I start developing that sense of work and work ethic. And that's something we would certainly want families to do regardless of whether or not their kiddo has a disability or not. And so that's kind of the other piece of that anticipatory guidance is really giving families some support to think about what they should be doing and how they can best support their loved one in reaching that kind of good life vision that they've established. So beyond the trajectory, another core tool in the toolkit is the concept of an integrated support star. So you'll notice that this integrated support star looks suspiciously similar to that outer ring of the LifeCourse framework that we reviewed, with good reason. So what this really does is it's a tool to help explore options as well as problem solve. So much like the trajectory, we can use this at any level. So we could use it at a person level, we could use it as a systems level, we could use it broadly. You know, for instance, you know, let's look at all of the supports in Kim's life, or we could look at it very narrowly to say, all right, Kim has said that she wants to work on employment, so let's do a star that helps us explore what that might look like. Or maybe a teen might be struggling in a particular area and they can use a star to kind of work through that particular issue or concern. So what you see here are some generic ideas and thoughts about what, you know, what gets put in some of these places. So you have at the top again personal strengths and assets, our relationship-based supports, eligibility-specific, community-based, and technology-based. So here's an example of what this might look like if a team were working on supported decision-making for a person, which would fall into that safety and security life domain. So this is a little small. I believe the slides will be shared with you, but you see, you know, within each of these, then we're looking at, well, from personal strengths and assets, does the person have the ability to communicate their wants and needs? That would certainly be a factor in this. Do they understand the concept of money? Do they carry their ID? Under relationships, we might be looking at, is there a power of attorney in place? Or would that be appropriate? Would that provide the level of support the person might need? Maybe it's a joint bank account. Down in eligibility-specific supports, we have the service coordinator or the case manager would be a great resource or tool or support in looking at supported decision-making. Does the person have a representative payee for their Social Security benefits? Then over on the community-based side, we might be looking at what are some of those common tools that are available to anyone, like a limited bank account or direct deposit, and how do we use those tools in supporting the person with their decision-making. And then finally, with technology, what are some of the options that we might have there that would be useful to support somebody as they're in making decisions about their life? So let's kind of pull this all together and see what it looks like. So this is Peyton. Peyton at this time was a young man who was in elementary school. Peyton's mom also is part of the team at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. So at the time that this that Peyton's story started, Peyton's school had him on a trajectory that he would leave school with a certificate and transition into facility-based employment options, and otherwise known to lots of folks as a perhaps sheltered workshop. And Peyton and his mom really didn't have that in their vision of a good life for Peyton. And so Peyton and his mom sat down and put together his good life trajectory. So it's a little hard to read, but what you'll see there is, you know, Peyton set a vision for a good life for him was friends, family, productive employment, happiness, living independently, meaningful relationships, love, community involvement, and inclusion. And it may be hard to see, but if you look close, you'll see that those are all in different colors, and those colors actually then correlate back to some of the areas, the areas around the integrated support star that we talked about. The things that he did not want in his life was sheltered workshop, group home, isolation, depending on paid supports, being lonely, unhappy, unproductive, bored, and being in poverty. And so Peyton and his mom took this star, or took this trajectory to his IEP meeting, and used it to communicate with his team at school that they had him on the wrong trajectory, and that he had a clear vision of where he wanted to head, and that they wanted the school to move in that direction. And thankfully, the school seemed very on board with that and started to plan using Peyton and his mom's vision of a good life down the road. And so on the screen here, what you'll see is some of the work then that the school and Peyton and his mom did, pulling from that vision, then what do those supports look like? So on the left, you see the integrated support star, where they started talking about what were his current strengths and assets, you know, what relationships he had in place. So you see his mom, his brother, his grandparents, his dad, and stepmom. You see, you know, he was receiving some in-home supports, some consumer-directed services. He was involved in church and Boy Scouts and bowling. And then he had tools that were really important to him from a technology perspective, like his iPad. And, you know, Peyton's mom relates that this was a really, you know, in addition to being really helpful in terms of looking at how his school supports could be most effective, it was really eye-opening for the school to see kind of that full, what Peyton's life looked like kind of in total, and what it looked like within the context of the family. On the right-hand side, what you'll see is then they started plotting kind of what was happening in Peyton's day, and how did it relate to those, to the integrated support star. And again, the colors may be a little hard to see, but you can see that they use the colors to say, you know, we've got in-home supports in the afternoon, so that's green. But then he's got Boy Scouts a couple nights a week, so that's blue to correspond with community-based supports. You know, mom is and dad are certainly providing a great amount of support for him, so that's all in purple. But you can start to see that his life is hopefully becoming more colorful. And I think that's one of the great kind of parts of using the integrated support star in particular, when you start to translate that into what does a person's day or week look like, is our goal is that we use all of the colors in the star and that their life is as colorful as possible. We don't want to see anybody's life be a single color, because that's not going to be the best for them in terms of a sustainable path forward towards their vision of a good life. So with Peyton, 1 year later, what changed? So Peyton was included, as a result of kind of that work with the school, Peyton was included in more general education classes and activities than he had in the year prior. His brother Connor, who also had an IEP, used the LifeCourse tools to actually lead his IEP meeting. And then the school was so interested in and impressed with the tools that they are looking at using those LifeCourse tools for all students, regardless of disability. So really a positive impact, not just for Peyton, but certainly for his for his family and for his community. And so I think that also leads us, to the kind of last principle, if you will, of the LifeCourse, and that's that, all of this is predicated on partnering with people with disabilities and their families so that they can engage, lead, and drive policy and systems changes. That, again, we're not doing things without folks, but we're doing them with them. And that they are an integral partner in the conversations and helping us to kind of move the system in some different directions. So next, let's talk about, well, what does that mean here in Indiana and the LifeCourse framework? So one of the things, kind of one of the first steps we took was to start to develop a structure for our work in the community practice. So this gives you kind of a quick overview of that, but we have at the top of this triangle, we have the community practice leadership. So that includes Kylie as the director of DDRS, and the directors for the bureaus that fall within DDRS, and Julie, and I and myself, we work to support them. It also includes an important partner, and that's Christine Dahlberg and Chad Crow from the Governor's Council for People with Disabilities. They are a partner in this effort with us, and really, if you recall at the beginning, we talked about getting to the all. I think they're a critical partner in helping us always kind of work towards that kind of all thinking and developing supports that really speak to all folks in the system. Kind of the leadership team is really focused on kind of helping kind of set that structure, develop some outcomes and expectations for the work plan. And then we have the state team, which is the DDRS Advisory Council, that really is focused on helping to develop and implement that work plan. In addition to that, we have engaged stakeholders, so folks like many of you who are on the call, folks who are really interested in this and really want to think about how they might be a part of the work that's happening and want to kind of assist with sharing information with others. And then kind of that statewide audience, looking at stakeholders at all levels to inform and educate. So in terms of what we have done activity-wise around the community practice, as I mentioned, we've got that community practice structure in place. In making the DDRS Advisory Council the state team, we wanted to expand that a little bit to make sure that we had all stakeholders represented. So we added a few positions or a few seats at that table. Namely, we invited the Governor's Council to be a part of those discussions as our partner in the project. We also invited, or we included a case management representative, which is Ann Robertson from IPMG serves in that role. We also looked at who we were including from an education perspective and making sure that the Department of Education had a seat at that table as well. And then in terms of kind of starting to look at actual systems and how we might start applying some of this LifeCourse thinking, really the first piece that came to the surface was case management and person-centered planning. And I think hopefully after seeing the LifeCourse, it might hopefully came to you as well that that seemed like an intuitive place to start, because I think embedding a lot of this LifeCourse thinking really starts at that relationship and how are we helping the person in developing that support plan that's going to support their whole life, not just their waiver life, and the role the case manager plays in making that an effective process. We're also looking at getting a group up looking at community employment. When we talked about kind of the forces that are pushing on our system, there are a lot that are oriented around employment and creating more opportunity in that area. And so that also seemed like a natural place to start applying these LifeCourse principles. Through activities like today's presentation, we are building towards a common understanding of the LifeCourse framework itself and looking at some of those tools. With the state team and the leadership team, we're continuing to also discover and explore other areas that we might want to start applying some of this LifeCourse thinking to. Consistent with the case management and person-centered planning that I mentioned earlier, we've integrated many of the principles that we've talked about today into the some of the changes that we're looking at for the person-centered ISP, individualized support plan process. And then we had a statewide kickoff meeting in March where we brought in folks from the national team to do some more one-day intensive training where we had the opportunity to bring case managers, providers, families, self-advocates together and really start delving into these activities. So before we wrap up or take questions, I also wanted to share, sometimes it's helpful to see, well, what are other states doing? What did this really mean in those states that came before us? So here's just a slide that kind of highlights just some of the activities that are the original states from the community of practice have dug into. So in Washington, D.C., they use the LifeCourse framework as a lens for developing an individual and family support waiver, very similar to our FSW waiver, but really used it as a way to effectively engage families and self-advocates in that process. Missouri used their LifeCourse planning and thinking to integrate their family-to-family network in their intake process. So if I had to analogize it to our system, they set up a process so that when someone, if this were in Indiana, presented to the equivalent of our BEADS office, that BEADS office would certainly take that person's intake information, but they would then make a direct referral to the family-to-family network so that the family-to-family network could reach out to that family or that self-advocate, welcome them, and offer information or answer any questions, things of that nature. So there was a high-level touch associated with that and hopefully helping the person, particularly with a focus. Do you remember the three types of supports, those support buckets? They took a particular focus on helping people to connect to those discovery and exploration type supports and the connecting and networking types of supports. Oklahoma has done lots of things, as the other states have, but one of the things that I thought was interesting that they have done is they've used that integrated star as a way to communicate about an individual across agencies to make sure that there are smooth transitions as folks move perhaps from one program to another or one funding source to another. Tennessee used the LifeCourse framework as a lens for improving their front door experience. So as folks were coming into their system, really looking at all of the hoops and hoopla that folks were put through and thinking about what was a more effective process that really was more aligned with supporting the concept of supporting families. Washington State used the LifeCourse framework to integrate or integrated the LifeCourse framework into their online planning tool for person-centered planning. So they translated a lot of the questions and that anticipatory guidance into an online app, actually, that folks can go in. It prompts them with some questions, but gives them a tool to help prepare for their person-centered planning meeting and the things that they might want to explore. And then Connecticut has embedded the principles in their home, in their in-home provider core competencies. So have made it part of the training requirements, essentially, for staff that they're steeped in the LifeCourse principles. So, like I said, this is just a sample of things. What I would encourage folks, if you have an interest in learning more, I'd encourage you to visit two websites. One, both of them are here. One is supportstofamilies.org, and that is the website for the National Community of Practice. So you'll see there's lots of information there. A couple things of interest. They host what they call their Innovation Series webinars. So those are typically held monthly. I anticipate we'll probably have one come up here in July or August. But they are usually about an hour and a half webinar where they do a deep dive either on one of the community practice states or on a specific kind of aspect of the LifeCourse framework itself. They have been doing those since January of 2015, and so there are recordings of all of those presentations, copies of the slide decks, that sort of thing, available to you on the website. So it's a great resource if you want to kind of, like I said, dig in and learn more about the Life Course itself or about any of the states who participated. And then lifecoursetools.com is a, kind of a supporting site, if you will, and it really has, it's got a rich array of templates of all of the trajectories that we walk through or the integrated support star. All of those are available there in various iterations. There's a lot of video recordings and samples and examples of ways folks have been using the Life Course across the state. So I will say I think it's a great rich resource, but you might be prepared that you kind of might spend a lot more time on that website than you anticipate, because there's just a lot of information, a lot of very interesting information. It's very easy to spend a good amount of time there, but hopefully well worth the time that you spend. And so with that, we always like to, before we take questions, we always like to kind of end where we began, as a reminder that, you know, all of this work is being done in support of this kind of overall outcome, that we're really looking at how do we use these tools, how do we use this framework to think about the way we support folks so that all people have the right to live, love, work, learn, participate, play, and pursue their dreams in their community. So with that, Jen, we'd be happy to answer any questions that folks have.
Great. So if you have any questions, feel free to type those in now. First, I just want to say thank you very much to Julie and Tim for giving us this information today. I think it's excellent that we get to hear this right from the experts that Tim and Julie are. So let's start with some questions. The first one is about the recording of this webinar. So just to recap, within a few days, everybody that has registered will get an email, and it'll have the presentation on it with the recording so that you're able to use that. And at any point, all of the professional development workshops that we do are housed on our website. So at any point, you could go to our website and obtain any of these as well. But you will get an email directly to you with that. One of the other comments is this is exciting. It is the obvious extension from the PCPs used before 2006. So people are excited about that.
Yay, we are too. We're very excited about it.
And we're getting some great job, Kim. Thank you so much. This is wonderful. Thank you very much. So some good feedback.
Good.
Any other questions that anyone has? Oh, here we go. The question is, how do we connect to be on the engaged stakeholder group? Is there an email group or meetings?
There is not. I would say just pay attention to the BEADS bulletins and those sorts of things. We're actually, I think, you know, last year, so as Julie said, we've been in this project not quite a year. So we joined, I think it was right about August of last 2016. And we really spent that kind of latter part of the summer and the fall getting out and talking with lots of folks. And we've been doing a lot of work in the past few months on working with an innovation work group of stakeholders looking at case management. And now Julie and I are kind of talking about how do we create kind of a consistent, now that we're past the kickoff meeting, kind of a consistent communication out to folks about what's happening with our work here and how it's starting to be integrated into the division's work. So I think what we've talked about is that will be communicated through through the typical BEADS bulletin system and through the website. So just keep an eye out for that. And then, you know, as we move forward, we're always looking for folks to provide feedback or insight into what's working, what's not, or what more information would be helpful as they explore the Life Course framework and using it in their own lives.
Great. We have another comment that says, thank you to all the presenters for your time. This was very informative. Someone had a question, will Life Course become standardized material for all case managers?
That's a really great question. And I would say at this point, The answer would be no, but I'm gonna with a small asterisk. So the asterisk is, as I mentioned, you know, the division is in the process of kind of revising the way that we do person-centered, the person-centered description or plan and the ISP. There's an opportunity with some changes that are happening with the technology that supports that process that we're going to be able to actually integrate that into a single process or document. And so with that movement, we are integrating some of the principles of the life course into it. So for instance, there will be a question, you know, we'll be looking at how do we support folks by looking at where they are in their life course and giving them some of those anticipatory guidance questions to use as they prepare for meetings. It will also be reflected. We've kind of built the P around the life domain so that folks are talking about all those areas. And I want to be clear, sometimes that makes folks nervous when we say that. And we are looking that we would talk about the person within all those life domains, but we also are talking about that it's perfectly acceptable for the person to say, you know, in the area of daily life and employment, I'm really happy with what's going on. Like, my vision of a good life, I'm living it. And so our plans and our strategies around that then are, how do we just continue to help support the person where they are? Although there may be some areas where the person wants to grow, and certainly we would talk about that as well. I think the other area where we've infused it is, as we're looking within each of those life domains, we're talking about what are the supports, both paid and unpaid, that would go into supporting the person in that particular area. Now, so that's the small asterisk, but beyond that, we really are looking at kind of creating a toolkit of tools that would include life course tools and other more traditional person-centered planning tools, and for case managers to use those as they feel is appropriate with the person that they're supporting. I think these tools, you know, some of these tools work well with certain folks, and I think it's important that case managers have the flexibility to use whatever tool is most appropriate for the person that they're supporting.
Great, thank you. Someone else asked or indicated they have several friends and family in Florida that I think could benefit from this system. Do the websites cover all states?
So that's another great question. So there are only 15 states, I think that's the right number, about 15 states who are part of the community of practice. So when you go to, let me go back, maybe. There we go. So if you go to that supports2families.org page, there is, within that site, there's a page for each of the states that's part of the community of practice. So you can see more specifically maybe what a specific state is doing. Now, if I'm remembering correctly, Florida is not part of the community of practice. However, if you have families or colleagues in that area that you think might benefit, what I would encourage you to do is direct them to the lifecoursetools.com website. Like I said, all of the tools are available there. And for me personally, I think the beauty of the Life Course tools is that they're very accessible for families and self-advocates to use on their own. And so even though their state might not be using those tools or that planning approach, I think certainly if it might work for a family that you know that, you know, that they can use it as part of their preparation for participating in whatever way their state handles person-centered planning and things of that nature, it might help them in just preparing for those activities.
Great. All right, last call. Any other questions anybody has before we let Julie and Kim go? Okay, I am not seeing any, so just want to say thank you again very much for your time and for presenting for us today. Many comments have come in. Thank you. It was wonderful. Good presentation. So thank you guys very much.
Wonderful. Thank you. We really appreciate the opportunity.
Bye, everybody. Hope you have a great day.